Hey there, good to see you in the second video of the series. Before we move forward, let's quickly recap of what we discussed in the last video. So in that video, we mostly focused on discussing the why part of the questions pertaining to the compulsory licensing regime in India. Here, we are going to answer questions such as who can apply, when can it be applied, and how can it be applied. Here in this video, I may talk in terms of sections and rules for your easy reference. But if you want to ignore the sections and rules and focus on the concepts, please feel free to do so. It's not going to hamper your understanding. So with that, let's get started. To begin with, let's answer the question of who can apply. As per section 84, any person interested, including the person who already has license on the patent, can submit a request to the controller for obtaining the compulsory license on the patent. The section further stresses that no person can be stopped or can be objected from raising a concern pertaining to the public interest or people's requirement, the reasonable requirement with respect to the invention in focus. In fact, it further says that no person can be disqualified from submitting such a request just because they already have a license or they accepted the terms and condition or made certain admissions while accepting the previous license. So in a nutshell, any person who can be categorized as a person interested can make such a request to the controller for obtaining a compulsory license. Now let's get into another question of when can it be applied. So as per section 84, any person interested can apply for CL after the expiry of 3 years from the grant of the patent. So basically, after the patent is granted, you need to wait for a period of 3 years. Once the period of 3 years is 3 years are expired, you can apply for a compulsory license. There's another interesting aspect here. You cannot directly apply for CL. You have to have a meaningful engagement with the patentee before you approach the controller. Now, what do you mean by meaningful engagement? What they mean is that you should have made some sort of efforts to reach out to the patentee to get a license on fair and reasonable terms, which is mutually benefited to both the parties. And you should have invested some efforts and time in negotiating the license, the terms and conditions, so as to obtain a license. And this period is taken as 6 months. So basically, for a minimum of 6 months, both the parties should have engaged with each other for ironing out any differences that could be there in granting or obtaining the license from the patentee. Now, in case you fail to do so, you can approach the controller as per section 84. But remember, you cannot go to the control as a first resort. You have to go to the patentee before approaching the controller. That's a basic requirement that is there. Now let's go into the how part of it, which is mainly the procedural and the process part adopted by the patent offices in terms of how a particular application needs to be looked into or what kind of processes needs to be followed to make an order or to pass an order to or to make a decision. So as per the rules which pertain to this are rules 96-201. So as per rule 96, section 84, any person interested can apply for a compulsory license using a prescribed form. I'm not going to discuss the forms, at least some saving grace. So once such a request has been submitted, the controller goes over the application. Now, Rule 97 says that if the controller is of the opinion that a prima facie case has not been made, then the controller notifies the applicant stating that the application may get rejected because he doesn't see any merit into the application. Accordingly, the applicant is given a time period of 1 month to respond or to attend a hearing to discuss the differences between the with the controller. Now, with the hearing, controller may make a decision or will make a decision in terms of whether the application will get rejected or application will be picked up for further processing. Now, if on the other end, if the controller is of the opinion that the application has merit or there is a prima facie case that has been made, that the controller asks the applicant to send a copy of such a request to the patentee as well. And such an application then gets published. After this, once the controller has notified and the applicant has also shares a document with the patentee, the patentee or any other person interested, but the parties who can be considered as interested party with respect to the patent in question can file for opposition. And in fact, they need to submit their response within a prescribed time period of 2 months. If they don't submit a response within 2 months, controller may see that there is no objection and may go ahead and grant the compulsory license. Now, one thing that we forgot to discuss, which is common across all applications and opposition, is the applicant needs to have a statement defining his standee, why he should be considered as a person interested, and then on what grounds he's actually applying the CL, and what are the terms and conditions that he's expecting for the license to be granted on. So these are the documents that are submitted to the controller, and the same documents are submitted to the patentee also for his understanding. Now the patentee within 2 months needs to object. Patentee also can come up with the statement with the objections and with the grounds that they rely on for objecting the application that has been submitted. Now interestingly, if the patentee is okay in granting a license to the applicant, then they can also provide the terms and conditions that they are okay with to grant the license to the applicant. The documents are received by the controller, the documents are shared with the applicant also. As a next stage, the controller fixes a hearing between the parties so as to discuss the statements, so as to discuss the evidences, so as to discuss the grounds and come up with an order. Now, before passing the order at this stage, the controller looks into little different parameters also. Now, what are these parameters? Now, the parameters could be related to the nature of the invention. What is the nature of the invention and how much time has elapsed from the grant of the patent? And what are the measures taken by the patentee for working the invention? Because there could be few inventions which requires a lot of effort, a lot of investment, and a lot of conducive environment for it to be worked. And there are other inventions which can be worked without much efforts or without much investment. So a due consideration is given to the nature of the invention also, because you cannot just say that 3 years were sufficient for working the invention. Some leeway is given based on the understanding. Similarly, because the applicant is asking for compulsory license on the grounds that the society is not getting benefited by it, so the controller needs to assure or ensure that the applicant can really work the invention for the benefit of the society. At this juncture, the applicant evaluates the ability of the controller evaluates the ability of the applicant, whether he would be able to work the invention to the benefit of the society. Similarly, the controller also checks the capability of the applicant in terms of his capacity to undertake risk and make investments for making the invention work. Because a lot of investment would be required for making any invention work at a commercial scale, which can benefit the society finally. And controller also checks whether there was any engagement, whether any engagement happened between the two parties or not. Because remember, the applicant has to reach the patentee first before reaching the controller. Now, taking into consideration all these parameters and the documents and the statements and the evidences that have been submitted by the parties, controller may come up with an order. Now, with this order, either the application is rejected or a compulsory license has been granted. So all good. The applicant has the compulsory license to his name. What next? What should be the next step? You may say practice the invention, right? But is it that straightforward? Can he just practice the invention just like that? See, if we go to the basics of the patents. So any technology that is claimed in any patent is invariably dependent on another technology which is claimed in another patent. So where are we going with this? It means that if he has to function or if he has to practice that invention, there could be scenarios where the applicant or the licensee may need to take license from other inventions also, because without that he will not be able to practice the invention in an efficient and satisfactory manner. And if he were to go ahead and practice, there could be infringements, and then there are another issue that needs to be solved. So what if the other patents, the related patents that we are talking about, were owned by the same patentee? In that case, the applicant may request the controller to grant license, compulsory license, on these related patents also. Controller goes over the application again, sees whether there is a merit or not, whether the invention, whether the compulsory license that was granted for the first patent, can he actually practice the invention without infringing these other patents. All that consideration is taken into account, and then the controller may give the grant to the other related patents also, which are owned by the same patent. Now at this stage, the section also takes into account the customers of the applicant. Now you may wonder, why the customers of the applicant, right? Now think of it. The applicant may be serving the customers, and maybe serving the customers, and because of the terms and conditions that have been put in the license by the patent owner, the customers may find it challenging to manufacture, sell, or use any other articles or any other products which are not even protected by the license, not even protected by the patent. But there could be terms and conditions which would be restraining these guys. So what can happen? So in this case, the applicant can go back to the controller and say that, hey, you need to take care of my customers also, because the manner in which the terms and conditions read, the customers are not able to use other products, other competitive products, let's say, or other products because of the terms and conditions which are not fair and reasonable. So in that case, what controller does? Controller grants the compulsory license to the customers also. Amazing, isn't it? So everybody is happy now, but patentee may or may not be happy. Now let's take another example where the person interested was the licensee, who already had the license to start with, but then for some reason he went back to the controller seeking the compulsory license, the CL. Now what happens when a CL is granted? What happens to the previous license? So the previous license can get rejected or cancelled, or may get amended to reflect the revised terms and conditions. So the previous licensee becomes the compulsory licensee now, and he's happy with the terms and conditions. All good. Now we have discussed various permutations and combinations pertaining to how can a compulsory license be granted. Now consider a scenario where compulsory license was granted, the applicant is happy, applicant is practicing the invention, but after practicing the invention for a while, the applicant realizes that the terms and conditions are not conducive for him to work the invention or to carry out his business or to derive any benefit from the invention. In fact, he's making losses, or he's incurring losses while working the invention. So forget about deriving benefits. So after all the excitement of snatching the CL from the patentee, our applicant is left in lurch. So what to do now? Our patent act has thought through this also. So section 88 provides a provision to that effect also. So section 88 says that a licensee, the compulsory licensee, can approach the controller with a request to revise the terms and conditions, because the terms and conditions were too heavy for him, or were not conducive for him to derive benefits, and he didn't envision all these troubles while signing the terms and conditions to start with. So controller can take this on record and may help the poor fellow in revising the terms and conditions. But do you think the patentee would take it in a spirited manner? No. First, a CL was snatched. Now the terms and conditions are getting revised. So under this also, the patentee is provided with an option to oppose. And the usual opposition happens where the applicant comes up with the reasons and statement saying that why the terms and conditions needs to be revised. And our patentee also will come up with his statements and his responses in terms of why the terms and conditions should not be revised. And finally, when all the evidences, all the statements, all the documents have been submitted to the controller goes back, goes over it, and then finally fixes a hearing for discussing all the differences that are there, and then come back with a decision in terms of whether the terms and conditions would be revised or will remain as it is. Now, there is a catch to it. How many times can a licensee approach the controller for revising the terms and conditions? Only once. And in fact, for the very first time also, when he goes to the controller, the licensee should have worked the invention, or should have worked the patent basically, for a period of 12 months, minimum period of 12 months. That has to be the case. Otherwise, everybody would just keep approaching the controller for revising the terms and conditions. So a due care has been given for the patentee also, even after snatching the CL from him. So with this, the normal scenarios are done with. There could be a question here. What happens actually? As soon as an application is submitted for CL, is there an obligation on controller to come back with a order immediately? Or can such an application or such an order be adjourned or can be deferred? So section 86 talks in favor of the patentee here, because not every invention can be worked immediately. There are multiple factors that gets associated when you want to work an invention. So section 86 says that if the grounds of a CL application are that the invention is not worked in India, or it's not worked in India on a commercial scale to a fullest extent that is possible, then the controller can listen to, or can provide an opportunity to the patentee to provide a reasoning in terms of why the invention was not worked in India, or was not worked in India on a commercial scale to the fullest extent possible. So the patentee can come up with various responses, various reasonings, and there could be reasons related to various impositions or rules, regulations imposed by maybe a state government or the central government, which are making it too difficult for there could be lockdowns, there could be some sort of bans because of which the patentee is losing time and money and is not able to work the invention. Under all these scenarios, the controller, in fact, there could be other reasons also, controller can take a decision to defer processing the application. How much can he defer? So the Act says, as per section 86, that for an aggregate period of 12 months, so once an application for CL being applied for, the processing can be adjourned for 12 months. So there is some sort of relaxation given to the patentee so that the patentee can maybe do something about the invention, can work the invention, and can try to resolve the conditions which have led to such an interest in CL. So this is section 86. Amazing. So now at this stage, we discussed everything on how CLs are granted based on various humanitarian conditions that can be invoked. I would want you to take back to the why part of the question. See, if you recall, every time a request is made for a CL, all such requests are invariably embedded with the notion of or the element of public interest, isn't it? The reasonable requirement of the public is not met, or the patented invention is not available at an affordable cost to the public, or the invention is not worked in India. Are there any other ways where a CL can be applied for? Think about the case that we discussed a while back. What about a person who is a patentee and who has got a patent on an invention? So what should he do? He needs to practice the invention, but as we know that his invention may depend on somebody else's invention because technologies are interdependent, improvements are interdependent. So he may need certain licenses for practicing his invention. So how does, in such a scenario where his invention is depending on another invention of another, claimed in another patent, don't get confused. First, so this is an applicant of who is a patentee, having an invention on a technology which is claimed in his patent. And this technology may depend on another technology of another patent. Simple line. So what should he do? You may say, go ahead and obtain a license. But what if the other patentee is not ready to give a license? What do? I cannot practice my invention without infringing his invention. And once I infringe the inventions, there are other problems that start for me. So what do? At this stage also, I can go to the controller with the request. Section 91 deals with such a provision. Now, section 91 says that a patentee of such an invention can request the controller for getting a compulsory grant on another invention which are required for working the invention of our patentee. He needs to work the invention in an efficient and satisfactory manner, which can only be done if I have a license from the other patentee. Again, you can put the statements, you can put the documents, you can put the evidences to let the controller know that you have a case in hand. Moving on, would the other guy be happy with this? He may not be happy with it, but the controller needs to make a decision. So what does controller do? So controller, apart from taking into account other parameters, also checks if this applicant is ready to give license in his invention to the other applicant, to the other patentee. You can consider it to be some sort of cross licensing. If the applicant is ready to do so, then usual to and fro happens between the patentee, this patentee, that patentee, and the controller, and finally an order is passed where controller may give license to this patentee also and license to that patentee also, so that both of them can practice their inventions. So with this, we have found multiple ways to challenge the exclusivity granted to a patentee. Basically, the patentee has been on the receiving end all the time and a CL has been snatched from the patentee. So you may feel for the patentee. In fact, I feel for the patentee because this is the guy who has actually put in the efforts to come up with the inventions, and we are snatching away the exclusivity, right? We are denting the exclusivity. So from the previous video, we know that the patentee also has a provision to request for terminating the compulsory license as per section 94. Now here also section 101, no, sorry, rules Rule 101 deals with the process that needs to be followed for requesting termination. Same way. So the patentee needs to come up with the statement, come up with the grounds, come up with the reasons which should convince the controller for terminating the compulsory license. So once the controller receives such a request from the patentee, controller notifies the licensee, the compulsory licensee, then the compulsory licensee can object to such a request being made by the applicant, the patentee. And then the statements, documents, and evidences are shared, a hearing takes place, and finally an order is passed by the controller. Now what can that order be? That order could be simply terminating the CL or retaining the CL, one of these. So with this, we have covered the processes, the timelines, and the rules which are used by the patent offices for dealing with requests pertaining to the compulsory licensing, both from the applicant point of view and the patentee point of view. Now, if you recall, we have been discussing about reasonable requirements and the terms and conditions, reasonable requirement of the public and terms and conditions related to the compulsory license. What are these and who actually defines them? So in the next video, we are going to discuss who defines the terms and conditions and what parameters are taken into mind while defining the terms and conditions, and who defines the reasonable requirement. Who tells that reasonable requirements are not met? What are the conditions that can lead to reasonable requirements being not met? So next video, video 3, we'll discuss these two aspects. And with that, we will be done with the entire, all the sections related to the compulsory license, which is section 82 to 94. So till then, read well and take care. Bye-bye.